Paul LaCour, Denmark's Edison. Let's turn back the clock to the time before the aeroplane. Otto Lilienthal has lost his life during one of his many pioneer flights. During that same year, Ford built his first automobile. A few years earlier, deaf-mute teacher Graham Bell invented the telephone. Edison invented the phonograph and later the incandescent light bulb. This is a time when technical inventions abound, as do spiritual and social movements and cultural breakthroughs. The year is 1897. At ASCO, Professor Paul LaCour erects this building, designed by P.V. Jensen Klint, who later designed Grundtvigs Church in Copenhagen. The wind turbine is delivered by Christian Sørensen of the Skanderborg Wind Motor Factory. We are inside the test turbine where Paul LaCour, researcher, inventor, physicist, meteorologist, writer, and teacher of physics and natural science at ASCO Extended Folk High School, carries on the research he started with the smaller test turbine in 1891. Today we know that more than 100 years ago, through experiments and analyses, Paul LaCour managed to become the world's actual pioneer behind today's power-producing wind turbines. Who was Paul LaCour? And what is his importance to posterity?
Der går en lige linje fra nutidens vindmøller, de mange tusind møller, der står over hele verden, og tilbage til Paul LaCours arbejde i slutningen af 1800-tallet og begyndelsen af 1900-tallet. Paul LaCour lavede et internationalt set enestående forskningsarbejde, og han blev en inspirator for mange generationer af møllebyggere over hele verden.
LaCour blev kaldt altruist. Han troede på det gode og det sejr. Senere var der nogen, der dømte ham som romantiker med en negativ betoning. Men faktisk så var han romantiker i ordets positive og filosofiske forstand. Han troede på enheden i naturen, ligesom H.C. Ørsted gjorde det. Tingene hang sammen.
Paul LaCour was born in 1846 at Skærsø, an estate near the town of Ebeltoft, graduating from Randers Grammar School in 1864 with an honours in physics. At 15, during my annual exam, I presented the Ptolemaic model, dumbfounding my teacher from the beginning to the end. The examiners were stunned and didn't hesitate to award the top mark, and I was exhilarated. At Copenhagen University, at the laboratory of the famous physicist Hans Christian Ørsted, Paul LaCour studies physics, majoring in meteorology. In 1869, he becomes Denmark's first qualified meteorologist. He makes field trips to Holland, England and Italy, and goes on long sea voyages to get close to weather phenomena. His curiosity and his inventiveness one day in his childhood landscape lead him to a method of calculating the height of layers of clouds. The invention is awarded a silver medal by the Scientific Society in 1871. Shortly after, he's asked to work on Tycho Brahe's Meteorological Journal of the 16th century. In 1872, Paul LaCour is appointed deputy director of the newly established Meteorological Institute, in charge of the introduction of the first Danish meteorological stations. He is tormented by his rank of deputy director, and while impatiently waiting for the slow telegraphic connections, he's immersed in sketches of various inventions. Would it be possible enabling more people to be on the wire at the same time? In 1875, he obtains the Danish patent of tuning fork telegraphy, where the use of different frequencies makes it possible for more than 12 stations to communicate simultaneously. At the time, Thomas Edison had reached a level of only 4. The Scientific Society now awards LaCour with a gold medal. And the invention is classified as one of the most important principles emerging within electromagnetism during the last 50 years. By then, Lacour has married Hulda, who interprets the invention in a letter to her Paul. When two hearts are in tune, like yours and mine, and one is set in motion by love and yearning, the other heart will feel quite similar tones. But the American patent falls through and is awarded to someone else. During the following year, Lacour is toiling so hard with his invention within multitelegraphy, the phonic wheel, whilst taking care of his job at the Institute, that he and Hulda and his sister Jenny have to go for a 9-month recreational stay in Italy. Returning back home, he depends on agents in the fierce US competition between world-class inventors. A patent can easily be snatched right from under his nose, and he's unaccustomed to the aggressive US business morale. All that is a novel in itself, but it also contributes to Paul Lacour's career change. Despite receiving warnings against discarding his promising career as an inventor and his scientific status in Copenhagen, in 1878, Paul Lacour decides to take a job as a teacher at Asko Extended Folk High School. The term extended means the school also offers scientific teaching. Based on Grundtvig's historical, poetic visions of school policy, Lacour involves science in his teaching by choosing an unprecedented historical approach. Hulda, Lacour's wife, who in her youth had been a student at Asko, and whose stepfather, Frederik Barfod, had worked in the circle around Grundtvig, looked forward to the change. But tragically, just a month after their arrival at Asko, Hulda dies in childbirth.
At hele højskolens lærerkreds var forsamlet om hendes dødsleje, det gjorde, at han blev svejset endnu tættere på højskolen ved den begivenhed, så, som nok en nogen tid knækkede ham menneskeligt set, men bragte ham så meget tættere og i så større afhængighedsforhold til fællesskabet på Asko Højskole, at han blev der resten af livet. Også selvom han få år senere fik tilbudt stillingen som direktør for det meteorologiske institut, så sagde han nej tak.
Lacour is now alone with 3 small children. His sister Jenny moves to Asko to help him keep house. As a teacher, Paul Lacour is interested in teaching historically, letting his students experience the discoveries of physical and mathematical laws and principles. A student recollects Lacour's description of the falling apple, evoking the dawn of Newton's understanding of the law of nature. In the audience, there was the most attentive excitement. Lacour's voice was trembling, his eyes were shining. And then Newton wrenched open the door to the world of new insights, and our eyes looked in there, wondering. Lacour combined deep scientific insight with a strong religious faith. Many were puzzled why such a clear-sighted scientist didn't really accept Darwin's theory of evolution, insisting instead on the authenticity of Genesis. The gear wheels of the world clock hold us in low esteem, lucky the one with faith in powers supreme. According to Martin Anderson Nexer, this was Lacour's response when he was pushed. A young, rebellious student, Jeppe Aakjær, who was one of the initiators of a debate club with a provocative aim to debate the shortcomings of the teaching, experienced Lacour becoming sentimental when involving the death of Hulda in his teaching. Why did that man choose such tearful themes? He wrote in his memoirs. At the same time Lacour was teaching and doing other activities, he wrote several textbooks. His most famous work, the 2-volume book Historical Physics, was written from 1896 to 1901. Here, he and his assistant and colleague, later Minister of Education, Jacob Appel, account for the arrangement of the universe, the laws of physics, and mechanical inventions. Generations of Danish and German physics students know this work, which was translated into German in 1906 and last reprinted in Danish in 1966. However, Paul Lacour's main effort would be within wind power. Here he combines his meteorological, physical and mathematical insights, and here makes use of his skills as a clear-sighted theorist, imaginative inventor and intuitive experimenter, not taking anything for granted. Huge amounts of energy pass over Asco, over the entire country actually, almost completely free of charge, while the country is importing lots of other energy forms and paying a high price. Why shouldn't wind become an obedient and inexpensive servant? Lacour expresses the idea in his notebook in January 1891 and sends a letter to his brother, Jörn Karl Lacour, president of the Royal Farm Household Society, stirs the interest of the Minister of the Interior, thus speeding the case all the way to the finance bill with a 4,000 kroner grant, and in May of that year, a small test turbine is ready. Lacour defines the first challenge of the project, restructuring unstable wind to an even power. A long series of experiments lead to the invention of the kratostat. This Greek word means power equalizer. A heavy weight and a lighter weight are hanging in pulleys, running on an endless rope, resting on a large wheel at the top and a small wheel at the bottom. Increasing pull from the turbine will increase the speed of the large wheel to lift the heavy weight on the rope. Decreasing pull will do the opposite. The result is an even rotation to be transferred to a fan at the end of a cylinder. He has now created a wind tunnel. Utilizing his previous invention of the phonic wheel, he can measure the speed of the fan to vary only 1 per 1,000. He has now created an important precondition for doing exact measurements of his turbine models in the tunnel. The kratostat makes Paul Lacour known all round Denmark as the people's inventor, and the newspaper Dannebro writes an enthusiastic article under the headline, Denmark's Edison. Lacour considered various methods of storing wind energy. He'd have the turbine pull a dynamo and have the power split water into hydrogen and oxygen through electrolysis. And in Italy, he finds an electrolytic device which he takes to Asco. At 4 p.m. on October 13th, 1894, Lacour turns on the hydrogen light for the first time in his dining room at Asco House, the neighbour of the test turbine. The world's very first wind-generated hydrogen light in a private home. Hydrogen and oxygen for the flame of the lamp are generated by rain and wind, since rain is the substance which is separated and wind produces the electricity provoking the separation. Many important personalities of the time visit the test turbine in order to see the fantastic hydrogen light for themselves. In the hydrogen lamp, hydrogen and oxygen become hydrogen gas, which is ignited and directed toward a zirconium incandescent body, emitting a clear white light. The newspaper Politiken's editor, Henrik Cowling, once again comparing Lacour to Edison. The year after, the experiments are expanded with a major light system for the Folk High School. Hydrogen and oxygen are led from gas containers in the test turbine via lead pipes to the school, 300 meters away. Lacour and Jacob Appel keep a thorough journal of the extensive experiments during the spring of 1895. To avoid explosions, an extensive lightkeeper directive is prepared. The lightkeeper has the sole right and duty to turn the lamps on and off and must politely but firmly turn away interference from others. Later, Lacour develops the automatic key referred to by people as the Lacour key. Lacour combines it with a modified kratostat and an accumulator system. The Lacour key disconnects the charging of the accumulator system when the turbine runs too slowly, and connects it when the charge voltage is high enough again. The building of the large test turbine in 1897 paves the way for Lacour's most important contribution to modern wind power, the groundbreaking measurements in two wind tunnels. We will try to give an impression of Lacour's tests of wind pressure in different blade profiles with different bevels. It's typical of Lacour that he secures his results by thoroughly cross-combining data. As Lacour tests various wind reception units and changes the number of blades, something strange happens.
På Lacours tid troede man stadigvæk, at det var en gammel tommelfingerregel blandt møllebyggere, at man skulle have så mange blade som muligt, og deres areal skulle være så stort som muligt. Det Lacour gjorde gennem sin forsøg, det var at vise, at faktisk jo færre blade man havde, jo bedre blev det.
Lacour's astonishing but convincing conclusions are accounted for in the journal The Engineer and in a lecture at the Association of Engineers in Copenhagen in 1897. A wind reception unit with clearance between the blades of the rotor must collect energy from other jets of wind than those hitting the blades. Also, the wind reception area must collect energy from the jets of wind passing the clearances of the blades. The contribution of the blade clearance seems to increase with the speed of the blades. Because of its inertia, this air will provoke a vacuum, speeding up the blade. Logically, the effect will be strongest on the front edge of the blade. Lacour's conclusions were clearly verified in the year 2000 by the Rezo Research Center and the Danish Technical University in their virtual wind tunnel.
Gennem sine eksperimenter der kunne Lacour påvise, at der var et sug på bagsiden af vingerne. Han kunne også påvise, at den optimale vindmølle opererer ved en tiphastighed, altså en hastighed af spidsen af vingen, som var større end vindens, der mange gange større end vindens. Og de ting er ikke nogen overraskelse for os. Nu har vi vores virtuelle vindtunnel. De samme ting kan vi se her. Vi ser suget på bagsiden af vingerne. Vi ser, at der er et optimalt tiphastighedsforhold, som ligger på omkring 7. Det, der sagen er nemlig, at det gælder ikke om at have så stort et vingeareal som muligt, men så stort et overstregareal, altså det areal, vingerne ser, når de drejer rundt omkring en hel cirkel. Det er det, der tæller. Og dermed foregreb han den moderne vindmølle gennem sine eksperimenter.
Turbine builder Sørensen's large six-blade cone wind reception area turns out to be unstable and must be replaced by a traditional four-blade wind reception area. In the year 1900, Lacour presents in Test Turbines 1 and 2 his total wind turbine research and its results. Lacour encounters strong criticism. Critics to whom the idea of wind power seemed romantic and ineffective now also say his research has wasted government money, since he's only found the same as wind turbine builders had always done. The importance of Lacour's results doesn't interest his critics. The pressure on Lacour generates political turbulence, thus jeopardizing his grant. But with professional support from the Association of Engineers, a reduced grant is adopted. However, on condition that the test turbine should now focus on the knowledge and use of electricity in rural areas. Paul Lacour therefore establishes the Danish Wind Electricity Society, founded on October 28, 1903, by 22 prominent Danes, including, for example, Thomas B. Tree and Alexander Foss. Lacour's main idea of the society is for the test turbine to contribute to the spreading of small wind power units in rural areas for agriculture and crafts, thus helping to stem the increasing migration from rural to urban areas. The year after, Lacour starts up classes at the test turbine for rural electricians, where for 3 to 6 months, craftsmen can learn electrical engineering and installation work. Some become fitters, others managers at small direct current stations, and some later become pioneers. Students such as Johannes Juhl, who lied about his age in order to be admitted. He was the man behind the Gedser wind turbine, erected by the Danish Power Stations Association in 1957, which became very important in the development of wind power. The turbine apprentices have fun putting engines on their bicycles and arranging motor races. Lacour's many activities often exceed the limits of his health. In 1907, he is appointed chairman of the Governmental Electricity Commission. In April 1908, Lacour visits Samsø in order to contribute to the electrification of the island. He comes home soaking wet. but nevertheless immediately begins working on the plans in his wind turbine office. He contracts a heavy flu, which deteriorates into pneumonia, from which he doesn't survive. Lacour's sudden death leaves Asco and the school deeply shocked. Martin Anderson Nexø writes in a feature in the newspaper Politiken, "Now passed away the spirit who more than any other opened the farmer's sense of the world's outward boundlessness and his sense of the endless riches of life inside himself. Paul Lacour was inventor enough to feel what it meant to be one in a small country. 10,000 young people went to his school, bearing indelible traces of his rich human nature, together with the 100,000 whose light he occasionally turned on. They are now sadly staring while he vanishes in the distance."
Det er svært at fange Lacours liv og virke i få ord. Når jeg tænker på det centrale karaktertræk ved ham, så var det nok det her med, at han så enheden i mangfoldigheden i naturen. Han levede op til Asker Højskoles krav til undervisningen og sigte på enheden i mangfoldigheden og få tingene til at hænge sammen. I sine opfindelser kunne han lade sig inspirere af anatomiske opdagelser til at udføre tekniske ting. I sin undervisning kunne han tage udgangspunkt i nære ting i fysikken og løfte foredraget og diskussionen op til hele altet, til universet, med en efterklang af den store plan, der var med universet. Eleverne måtte selv drage deres konklusion om, at der stod en guddommelig plan bagved.
In 1916, 8 years after Lacour's death, about 120 small electricity-producing windmills had been erected in Denmark. And from 1900 to 1930, about 20,000 wind turbines were set up. Danish wind power research is at the international forefront.
På Forskningscenter Risø er 130 forskere beskæftiget med forskning inden for de samme problemkredse, som Paul Lacour beskæftigede sig med på forsøgsmøllen i Askov. Og derudover rent praktisk også undersøgelse af vingers styrke og levetid. Vores forskere kombinerer matematik, fysik, konstruktion og meteorologi. Det samme gjorde Paul Lacour.
Ja, Lacour nåede enormt meget inden for vindkraftens område. Han nåede at beskrive de fundamentale fysiske love, der gælder for vindmøller, vingernes antal på en mølle, på hvordan de skulle nærmere udformes. Han nåede at løse problemet om, hvordan man oplagrer vindkraften. Han nåede at beskrive, hvordan man kan gøre kraften fra en vindmølle helt jævn ind til en promilles nøjagtighed med sin gradostat. Og så som kronen på værket, den elektrikeruddannelse, han fik indrettet på Asker Højskole. Mange landsbyer kunne ved hjælp af disse nye uddannede elektrikere fra Asker få deres lille kraftværk baseret på tegninger fra forsøgsmøllen. Så han er en af de få, der spænder fra grundforskning i fysik og så frem til den slutanvendelsen ude hos forbrugeren, hvor hans elever har sat sikringer ind til at sikre strømmen.
Danmark har i dag et stort forskningsprojekt, der hedder Brintsamfundet. Visionen er at frembringe størstedelen af fremtidens el ved hjælp af vedvarende energikilder og i kombination med brint. Det er den samme vision, som Paul Lacour havde for mere end 100 år siden.
From 1975 until the year 2000, around 6,500 power-generating wind turbines were erected in Denmark. In 2001, their total effect corresponded to 20% of the country's annual consumption of electricity. In 2012, wind power covered 26%, and the years to come promise a steadily progressive increase.